In the United States in 2013, it's easy not to think much about measles because we really don't have to. It's pretty much gone in the United States. But that's a really remarkable story. And that's what I'm going to tell you about for the next 15 minutes or so. How scientists and public health officials and healthcare providers and individual families made the decisions and took the actions that led to measles pretty much disappearing in the United States. Now, the first thing you need to know about measles is that it's a pretty bad disease. And almost all the people who get it are children. Now, many times it's not complicated. There's a fever, there's rash, there's cough, there's watery eyes, but the child fully recovers and is not too sick, and after that's immune. But sometimes there's complications. Ear infections are pretty common, so is pneumonia, and sometimes there's serious neurological problems, and some people who get measles die. The next thing you need to know about measles is it is really, really contagious. How contagious is measles? Well, let me give you an example. There was a measles outbreak in a children's hospital in the early 1890s. And in this hospital, there were 62 children who were 2 years of age or older at the time the measles outbreak took place. 5 of those children had already had measles, so they were fine. They didn't get measles again. They were immune. But of the 57 other children, 55 of them got measles during that outbreak. Only 2 children managed to evade infection. There was another interesting observation out of this outbreak. There were also 113 children under age 2 in the hospital, and 78% of them ended up getting measles. But not one of the children under 6 months of age got measles, and that's because if the mother has had measles before, antibody gets passed to the baby, and the baby's protected for those first months of life. So that's how contagious measles is. In a setting like this, almost everybody who's susceptible ends up getting infected. Now, historically, there were island populations where measles may have not been there for decades. And when the virus finally came, there could be really devastating outbreaks that with terrible consequences. There was an outbreak like that in Fiji in 1875. And the estimates are that 40,000 people died, probably more than a quarter of the population. This photograph was recently published in the Fiji Times, and it's the site of a mass grave from that era. Now, you know, that was the 19th century. Medical care is better now. Do people still die from measles? Well, yes, they do. There's been a measles outbreak going on in France in recent years, and health authorities there report that there have been more than 22,000 cases, and there have been 10 deaths reported for a death-to-case ratio of about 1 in 2,200. Even with modern medical care, people can die of measles. Of course, without it, the risk is higher. It's also more likely to be fatal for very young children, for malnourished children, and for people who don't have normal immune systems. So what happened in the United States? Well, for a very contagious disease like measles that basically everybody gets, on average, the number of cases of disease are going to be about the same in a year, on average, as the number of people who are born. And so not all those cases get reported, get diagnosed. But what we had in the United States before the 1960s were hundreds of thousands of cases of measles reported each year. We also had, during the 1950s, tens of thousands of hospitalizations and hundreds of deaths. So that's what was going on in the United States. Look what happened in the early 1960s. Disease went much, much lower very abruptly. And the reason that happened was we had a vaccine. For the first time that we could prevent measles with, and it was pretty widely used. And over the next couple of decades, many states implemented school immunization requirements. So in order to go to school, a child had to have proof of measles immunization. And there were parts of the country where basically all the kids in school were vaccinated. Is that enough to make measles go away? Is that enough to stop this person-to-person transmission for a disease that's that contagious? Well, if we think about how disease spread, it goes from person to person to person, right? And on average, if each case of measles results in more than one case of measles, if the person managed to spread it to more than one person, the number of cases is going to increase. If on average each case of measles only spreads to less than one person, the number of cases decreases. And if that pattern can be sustained over a long period of time, the disease will go away. It will no longer spread in that population. How much of the population needs to be immune in order for this to happen? Well, measles is very contagious. So about 95% of the population needs to be immune in order to not have measles be able to continue to spread, on average, from person to person to person. So what happened in the United States? Well, we had pretty good coverage among school-aged children, and certainly in some schools, almost everyone was vaccinated. But there were outbreaks of measles in the 1980s, and it turned out that we actually did not have a large enough population of young people to be immune from measles to keep these outbreaks from happening. Even in a school where everybody was vaccinated, we could still have an outbreak of measles. And that's because the vaccine didn't provide 100% protection. Not everybody who got vaccinated was protected, maybe 90%, 92%, but not everybody. And so in a high school with 1,000 kids, everybody could be vaccinated and there still could be 50 or 80 or 90 kids who were still susceptible and we could still have outbreaks. And that's what happened in the 1980s. So in 1989, we started giving a second dose of measles vaccine, either before school or during school, in order to get that level of immunity higher among kids in school. So did that make the problem go away? Did measles go away then? Actually, it didn't. We had a big resurgence of measles between 1989 and 1991 that wasn't in those school-age kids, it was in the kids who weren't in school yet. We did a very good job of getting kids that first dose of measles vaccine before they started school, but we didn't do such a good job of getting kids vaccinated on time, around the time of their first birthday. And remember, as soon as maternal antibody wears off, children are going to be susceptible until they get vaccinated. And if we don't get them vaccinated on time, we could have an outbreak. And that's what happened during that period of 1989 through 1991. There were more than 55,000 cases, 11,000 hospitalizations, and 123 deaths. So we had a problem. There was a big national effort to get children vaccinated on time that continues to now, as well as implementing that second dose recommendation. And with both of those things, getting the first dose given on time to more kids and getting the second dose recommendation for kids in school, measles went way, way down. And by the middle or late 90s, there were just a couple hundred cases a year. Had we actually managed to have the level of population immunity that meant we no longer had that person-to-person-to-person transmission, had we been able to eliminate it? Well, we weren't sure. Certainly, a lot of the cases we were seeing in the United States were associated with travel. There were travel histories. People had traveled. They spread measles to other people. So that was certainly a big part of it. And we also knew that state and local public health officials worked really hard to identify suspected cases of measles and work them up and see what was going on. But were we really sure we'd broken that chain of transmission? Well, it turns out that different measles viruses that are in different countries are a little bit different from each other. They're different enough that you can tell them apart in the laboratory. They fall into different genotypes, is what they're called. Now, they're all close enough to the same that the vaccine prevents all of them, but they can be distinguished in the laboratory by genetic typing methods. And what we found was that the viruses we were seeing in the United States reflected travel and importation of measles virus from other places. That virus that had caused the big resurgence in the United States during the period 1989 through 1991 was gone. It wasn't in the US anymore. That's not what our measles cases were caused by. They were caused by importation from other countries. So in 2000, a group of outside experts reviewed the whole situation and all the information we were able to collect and concluded that we no longer had ongoing transmission of measles in the United States. We had managed to break that chain, which is really pretty remarkable. But of course, we're still at risk. You know, the virus can come back anytime a plane lands. It can be imported. It's important to maintain a high level of population immunity. People still need to be vaccinated. It could come back. It's come back in some other places. But we've been able to keep the lid on it, and that really is a tribute to a lot of people doing a lot of hard work. So what happens when a disease disappears? Well, one thing that happens is that doctors don't think about it anymore, and they may miss the diagnosis. They may not recognize it. They may have never seen a case. So when they do see one, they may not make the diagnosis. It may be delayed for a long time. They may admit the patient to a hospital thinking it's something else, not implement infection control precautions, have spread, have delays. So that's one thing that happens. Another thing that happens is for individual parents, they may think about the risks and benefits of vaccination differently. Back in an era when parents remembered measles, they might have had it themselves, they may remember other people being really ill with it, it was a pretty straightforward decision to make when it was time to vaccinate your child. But when the disease is gone, how do you think about risks and benefits? Now, the measles vaccine we use is combined with the mumps and rubella vaccine as MMR, and it's a very safe vaccine. But like any pharmaceutical product, there are side effects. There are risks associated with vaccination. It's just that those risks are way, way less than the risks of getting disease. But if you don't feel like your child is at risk of getting the disease, is that a risk you're willing to take? And for some parents, they aren't. And some parents make a decision to not vaccinate their children. And what that leads is a situation where potentially we no longer could have herd immunity in communities. So what's herd immunity? The idea with herd immunity is that a disease is passed from person to person to person to person. And there are some people who can't be vaccinated because they're too young, or they've got an underlying condition and the vaccine's contraindicated, or they could have been vaccinated and think they're protected, but they're not because they're one of those people that the vaccine didn't take in. But those people can be protected if the people around them are immune, which keeps the virus from getting to them. And I've got a little animation I want to show you that makes this point really well. So this is a population that's completely susceptible. Think about that hospital outbreak in 1892. And so here's what happens when measles comes through. Almost everybody gets it. So we go on to a situation in a community where there's a high level of immunity. Look here, all these people who are green, they're all protected. And there's some susceptible people left, but see what happens when measles comes through. Those susceptible people are protected because they're surrounded by immune people and break that chain so that person-to-person-to-person transmission doesn't find them. What happens when susceptibility is higher in that community, when not so many people are protected? What we see is that path of person-to-person transmission finds many of those susceptible people. We're not able to protect the people that can't be vaccinated if a level of immunity in the overall community is low. What we've seen in recent years are outbreaks of disease that have occurred in communities where people have made a decision not to vaccinate their children. There was an outbreak like this in San Diego in 2008, where a child came back from a trip to Europe, had measles, managed to pass measles on to other children in the household, in school, and in a doctor's office, where a number of infants who actually were too young to be vaccinated were exposed to measles. And people who make the decision not to vaccinate aren't randomly spread through the population. They tend to go to the same schools, live in the same neighborhoods. So there is some clustering of susceptibility that increases risk. Probably every one of you have heard that know that there are people who are concerned about the safety of vaccines, about vaccines and autism. Since this issue first came up more than a decade ago, there's been a lot of really excellent science that's been done to address it. And those studies have been really reassuring. But we know that some parents do still have concerns. In a recent survey, parents of young children were asked, what concerns, if any, do they have about childhood vaccines? And 15% of them said that vaccines may cause autism. Fortunately, we know that with effective communication skills, healthcare providers can work with parents, and many of them will make a decision to protect their child by vaccination. Now, my focus has been on the U.S., but of course, this is a global issue. We're part of the global community, and any traveler who comes into this country could bring measles from anywhere. We're all connected together, and as long as measles is anywhere, the U.S. remains at risk. Many regions of the United States have already established measles elimination goals. Those are the black dates on the graphic. And if all of the regions eliminate measles, it will be gone. It won't be an easy thing to do, but it's not impossible. It could be done. It will take a very high level of population immunity, and what that means is it's going to take a lot of political will. It's going to take effective immunization programs that really get into every community. And it's going to mean that parents all over the world have to make that decision to protect their children by vaccinating them. But if we do that, measles can be gone for good.